Hello friends, my name is Akash and I welcome you all in the video lecture series of LLB semester 2. So friends, this is the part 2 of the first lecture. So I would request you all, those who have not watched my first video, to go and watch my first video in which I have discussed the topics of unit 1, and in this lecture I will discuss the topic of unit 2. So as you can see the syllabus of topic 2, we have sources of international law, statute of the ICJ, international treaties and conventions, international customs, and then we have general principles of law recognized by civilized nations, and then we have judicial decisions, and as far as other sources of international law are concerned, we have resolutions of General Assembly and the resolutions of Security Council. So friends, these are basically the broad themes, we can say the broad topics of unit 2. Today we will deal with the first source, which is international custom. And when we deal with this first case, as you can see, the right of passage over Indian territory, Portugal versus India, this is the first case. So with the help of first case, we will try to understand that how international custom is one of the source of international law. So friends, moving ahead, I will try to make you explain the concept. So if you try to understand the concept, why would a nation seek a right of passage? Just try to understand this concept. When we talk about right of passage, it means that suppose we talk about water passages, we talk about air passages. Suppose if a country, a foreign country, is seeking right of passage from India, then whether it is obligatory upon us to grant the passage to that nation. For example, suppose if a country is seeking air passage over India, then are we bound to give that air passage? Suppose if a country is seeking maritime passage, in law of sea you will find that within the 12 nautical miles, even within the territorial waters of India, foreign ships have right to innocent passage. So when we talk about right of passage, whether are we bound to give right of passage to any foreign country? This is the basic concept which you need to understand in this whole lecture, and we will talk about the right of passage. So friends, moving ahead, why would a nation seek a right of passage? Because the territories over which the passage is sought may not belong to the nation seeking the passage. Suppose, as you can see, there are two nations. This is nation A, and then you can see that this is nation B. Now nation A is seeking right of passage from, so territories over which the passage is sought. Suppose these are the territories over which the passage is sought, and because the territories over which the passage is sought may not belong to the nation seeking the passage. Now if we can say, if this is the nation A seeking passage from country B, it means these territories do not belong to nation A. So can India exercise its regulation over those passages? Now suppose tomorrow, if any foreign country is seeking right of passage from India, suppose a country is seeking right of air passage from India, can we say that we will not grant you passage? We can deny that passage. Why? If that passage is threat to our sovereignty and integrity of India, if that passage is threat to the security of our nation, we can say that we deny that right of passage. So similarly, here in this case, we can also deny the right of passage. So the right of passage is subject to our Indian regulation. This is basically what you need to understand, and this is the crux of the entire second case. So friends, yes, we can exercise our regulation over those passages, and it may be subject to our regulations. So if another question arises, that is there any obligation upon India to the passage mandatory? Are we bound to give the passage? Are we bound to give that passage? It is mandatory upon us. Is it mandatory upon us? So as you can see, does this right of passage seeking is based on the international custom? So basically what I am trying to explain you is that this right of seeking passage is based on international custom, and this custom later on becomes the part of international law. So if we try to understand that a custom develops, and over the period of time this custom converts into something which is known as right in the international arena. So this is how international law is being formulated. So you will understand the topic more as we proceed with the case. So moving ahead, in this case, Portugal claims right of passage between Daman and the enclaves for the exercise of its sovereignty over the enclaves. So there is another concept of enclaves which I will discuss right now. So basically, in this case, Portugal was seeking right of passage from India over the territories between Daman and its enclaves. So as you know that Daman was a Portuguese territory. Fine. So Portugal sought the right of passage between its territories and the enclaves. Now I will explain you what do we understand by enclaves. Suppose a enclave is a part of territory of a nation state enclosed by the territory of another nation state. So try to understand this concept. Enclave is a part of territory of a nation state enclosed by the territory of another nation state. It means, suppose if we have nation A, this is the territory of nation A. Within this nation A, we have territory of another nation. This is territory of another nation B, this entire area. So friends, this is the region, as you can see, this is the enclave of nation B within nation A. So enclave is a part of territory of nation state enclosed by the territory of another nation state. So within the territory of nation A, this region is the enclave of territory B. So as we can say that suppose if this is the territory of India, then this we can consider, hypothetically we can consider that this might have been the territory of Portuguese. Fine. So Portugal claimed sovereignty over the enclaves and the exercise of right of passage. So suppose this is India and this is the enclave of Portugal within India, and this is suppose Daman, another Portuguese territory. So Portugal is asking right of passage from this territory to this territory. So Portugal is asking this right of passage. So whether are we bound to give this right of passage to Portugal? This is what we will try to understand in this whole case. So Portugal claimed sovereignty over the enclaves. So first we will try to find out, as far as these territories are concerned, whether Portugal had sovereignty over these territories or not. If Portugal had sovereignty over these enclaves, then Portugal was rightly justified in asking for its rights. Fine. So moving ahead with the case, as you can see, I will discuss you the summary of the case issue. So Portugal claims a right of passage between Daman and the enclaves for the exercise of sovereignty over the enclaves. So Portugal claims the right of passage. Portugal is claiming the right of passage. It further claims that India is under obligation to exercise its power of regulation. It means, and not to prevent the passage, it means Portugal is claiming that fine, India is bound to give us the right of passage. This is what Portugal is claiming in this case. And moving ahead, Portugal relies on the treaties of Pune of 1779, and further the Portugal relies on the degrees and sonnets issued by the Maratha ruler in 1783 and 1785. So, and further, India objects on various grounds. India objects that no, Portuguese had no sovereignty over those territories, and even if Portuguese had sovereignty over these territories, then we will not grant the right of passage because it is subject to our regulation. Obviously, if tomorrow there is a war of India with another nation, and if any country will seek the right of passage, air passage, then we can deny that air passage, that no, your right of air passage would undermine our sovereignty and security of our nation. So we can deny that passage. So similarly, this is the broad summary of this case. So moving ahead, as you can see, three questions were to be determined in this case, that whether Portugal claims a right of passage, fine, whether Portuguese sovereignty over the villages was recognized by British, and in fact India or not. So before the advent of British, as you can see, first we will try to determine whether Portuguese sovereignty over the villages was recognized by the British and later by India or not. whether its sovereignty was recognized or not. And if its sovereignty was recognized, then whether Portuguese had established the right of passage or not. This was the second question. And the third question, if the Portuguese had established the right of passage, whether it was subject to Indian regulations or not. So friends, these three questions were dealt by the court in this case. And moving ahead with the topic, as you can see, we will try to analyze the observations of the court. And the court said that what actually in the initial phase, what was granted to the Portuguese was only a revenue tenure. It means Portuguese were allowed to go and collect the revenue over those villages, and later the Portuguese held themselves out as the sovereign over the villages. Fine. So over the period of time, Portuguese started claiming sovereignty over those villages. Today, why we are claiming sovereignty over our territories? Because those territories are integral part of our nation. Similarly, at that point of time, Portuguese started claiming sovereignty over those villages. And later, this Portuguese sovereignty over the villages was recognized by the British. So over a period of time, the Portuguese sovereignty over those territories were recognized by the British. What happened next? So fine, the first question was answered by the court. Court said, yes, we agree that over the period of time, the sovereignty of Portuguese was recognized over those territories and British recognized their sovereignty. Fine. And as far as now, what was the second question? That even if the sovereignty was recognized, that whether the Portuguese had the right of passage or not. As far as the right of passage is concerned, there are two aspects which you need to understand. The first is right of passage regarding the private persons, civil persons, civil authorities. And the second is right of passage regarding the armed forces. So we will understand the right of passage in respect of these two entities. So the court said that as far as the passage of private persons and civil officials are concerned, it was not subject to any restrictions beyond the routine control. So in case of private persons, there was routine control over the passages by India. But as far as the right of passage of, so the court is therefore of the view that no right of passage in favor of Portugal has been established in respect of armed forces. It means as far as the armed forces were concerned, they had no right over the passages. It means the prior authorization of India, prior approval of India was needed before the armed forces of Portuguese could enter our territory. So as far as the civil persons were concerned, there was normal control and nothing more beyond the routine control. As far as the passage of armed forces were concerned, there was prior approval before the right of passage was granted. So this is the second question court answered that fine. This is the second question as far as the right of passage is concerned. As far as the third question is concerned, that even if the right of passage is established, fine, then whether India had right to obstruct that right of passage. The events that took place in Dadar on 21st and 2nd July 1954 resulted in the overthrow of Portuguese authority in that enclave. This created the tension in the surrounding Indian territory. Thereafter, all passage was suspended by India. It means, friends, it means that at that point of time, there were some conflicts, there were some disputes, there were some tensions around that part of the territory. And then finally, due to those tensions, the right of passage of Portuguese was suspended by India. And fine, the court was finally of the view that India's refusal of passage was covered by its power of regulation and control. So friends, the court held that India's refusal of passage was covered by its power of regulation and control. It means India had full authority to obstruct the right of passage of Portuguese as far as the sovereignty and integrity of our nation was concerned. It means the Portuguese right of passage was subject to our regulation and control. So in this manner, that third question was answered by the court. So from in this entire case, we have understood that Portuguese had the right of passage, but that right of passage was subject to Indian regulations and moving ahead. So friends, what we understand from the whole topic is that the right of passage, the claim of right of passage is based on the international custom, and this international custom later becomes the part of international law. As I have told earlier, as far as the right of passage over maritime, over the sea boundaries are concerned, the foreign countries have right of innocent passage over our Indian territories. So that right of claiming the innocent passage is also the result of the custom, that gradually this custom developed, and that is the international custom, that on the basis of international custom, of the international rights and obligations upon the nation states are developed. So friends, I would kindly request you all to just read the case after watching all the lecture, and finally, if you have any doubt in this case, then you can please ask all your queries. So friends, thank you so much.